This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Anglicanism is a tradition within Christianity comprising the Church of England and churches which are historically tied to it or hold similar beliefs, worship practices and church structures. The word Anglican originates in Ecclesia Anglicana, a medieval Latin phrase dating to the Magna Carta 1215 and before, which means the English Church adherents of Anglicanism are called Anglicans. The great majority of Anglicans are members of churches which are part of the International Anglican Communion. There are, however, a number of churches that are not within the Anglican Communion which also consider themselves to be Anglican, most notably those referred to as continuing Anglican churches, and those which are part of the Anglican Realignment Movement. Anglicans base their Christian faith on the Bible, traditions of the Apostolic Church, Apostolic Succession, Historic Episcopate, and writings of the Church Fathers. Anglicanism forms one of the branches of Western Christianity, having definitively declared its independence from the Holy See at the time of the Elizabethan religious settlement. Many of the new Anglican formularies of the mid-16th century corresponded closely to those of contemporary Reformed Protestantism. These reforms in the Church of England were understood by one of those most responsible for them, the then Archbishop of Canterbury, Thomas Cranmer, as navigating a middle way between two of the emerging Protestant traditions, namely Lutheranism and Calvinism. By the end of the century, the retention in Anglicanism of many traditional liturgical forms and of the episcopate was already seen as unacceptable by those promoting the most developed Protestant principles. In the first half of the 17th century, the Church of England and associated episcopal churches in Ireland, Church of Ireland, and in England's American colonies were presented by some Anglican divines as comprising a distinct Christian tradition, with theologies, structures, and forms of worship representing a different kind of middle way, or via media, between Reformed Protestantism and Roman Catholicism, a perspective that came to be highly influential in later theories of Anglican identity and expressed in the description of Anglicanism as Catholic and Reformed. Following the American Revolution, Anglican congregations in the United States and British North America, which would later form the basis for the modern country of Canada, were each reconstituted into autonomous churches with their own bishops and self-governing structures, which, through the expansion of the British Empire and the activity of Christian missions, was adopted as the model for many newly formed churches, especially in Africa, Australasia, and the regions of the Pacific. In the 19th century, the term Anglicanism was coined to describe the common religious tradition of these churches, as also that of the Scottish Episcopal Church, which, though originating earlier within the Church of Scotland, had come to be recognized as sharing this common identity. The degree of distinction between Reformed and Western Catholic tendencies within the Anglican tradition is routinely a matter of debate both within specific Anglican churches and throughout the Anglican Communion. Unique to Anglicanism is the Book of Common Prayer, the collection of services that worshippers in most Anglican churches used for centuries. While it has since undergone many revisions and Anglican churches in different countries have developed other service books, the Book of Common Prayer is still acknowledged as one of the ties that bind the Anglican Communion together. There is no single Anglican church with universal juridical authority, since each national or regional church has full autonomy. As the name suggests, the churches of the Anglican Communion are linked by affection and common loyalty. They are in full communion with the See of Canterbury, and thus the Archbishop of Canterbury, in his person, is a unique focus of Anglican unity. He calls the once-a-decade Lambeth Conference, chairs the meeting of primates, and is president of the Anglican Consultative Council with a membership estimated at around 85 million members. The Anglican Communion is the third largest Christian communion in the world, after the Catholic Church and the Eastern Orthodox Church. Contents 1. Terminology 11. Definition 2. Anglican identity 21. Early history 22. Development 23. Theories 3. Doctrine 31. Catholic and Reformed 32. Guiding principles 321. Distinctives of Anglican belief 33. Anglican divines 34. Churchmanship 35. Sacramental doctrine and practice 351. Eucharistic theology 4. Practices 41. Book of Common Prayer 42. Worship 421. Eucharistic discipline 43. Divine office 431. Choirs and places where they sing 5. Organization of the Anglican Communion 51 Principles of Governance, 52 Archbishop of Canterbury, 53 Conferences, 54 Ordained Ministry, 541 Episcopate, 542 Priesthood, 543 Diaconate, 55 Laity, 56 Religious Orders, 57 Worldwide Distribution, 58 Ecumenism, 59 Theological Diversity, 591 Conflicts within Anglicanism, 6 Continuing Anglican Movement, 7 Social Activism, 71 Working Conditions and Christian Socialism, 72 Pacifism, 73 After World War II. 8 Ordinariates within the Roman Catholic Church, 9 See also 10 References, 101 Notes, 102 Citations, 11 Further reading, 12 External links. Terminology: Jesus depicted in a stained glass window in Rochester Cathedral, Kent. The word Anglican originates in Ecclesia Anglicana, a medieval Latin phrase dating to at least 1246 that means the English Church. Adherents of Anglicanism are called Anglicans as an adjective. Anglican is used to describe the people, institutions and churches, as well as the liturgical traditions and theological concepts developed by the Church of England as a noun. An Anglican is a member of a church in the Anglican Communion. The word is also used by followers of separated groups which have left the Communion or have been founded separately from it, though this is sometimes considered as a misuse. The word Anglicanism came into being in the 19th century. The word originally referred only to the teachings and rites of Christians throughout the world in communion with the See of Canterbury, but has come to sometimes be extended to any church following those traditions rather than actual membership in the modern Anglican Communion. Although the term Anglican is found referring to the Church of England as far back as the 16th century, its use did not become general until the latter half of the 19th century in British parliamentary legislation referring to the English established church. There is no need for a description, it is simply the Church of England, though the word Protestant is used in many acts specifying the succession to the crown and qualifications for office. When the Union with Ireland Act created the United Church of England and Ireland, it is specified that it shall be one Protestant Episcopal Church, thereby distinguishing its form of church government from the Presbyterian polity that prevails in the Church of Scotland. The word Episcopal is preferred in the title of the Episcopal Church, the province of the Anglican Communion covering the United States and the Scottish Episcopal Church, though the full name of the former is the Protestant Episcopal Church of the United States of America. Elsewhere, however, the term Anglican Church came to be preferred as it distinguished these churches from others that maintain an episcopal polity. Definition: Anglicanism, in its structures, theology and forms of worship, is commonly understood as a distinct Christian tradition representing a middle ground between what are perceived to be the extremes of the claims of 16th-century Roman Catholicism and the Lutheran and Reformed varieties of Protestantism of that era. As such, it is often referred to as being a via media or middle way between these traditions. The faith of Anglicans is founded in the Scriptures and the Gospels, the traditions of the Apostolic Church, the historical episcopate, the first seven ecumenical councils and the early Church Fathers. Among these councils, especially the premier four ones, and among these fathers, especially those active during the five initial centuries of Christianity, according to the quinquasecularist principle proposed by the English bishop Lancelot Andrews and the Lutheran dissident Georg Calixtus, Anglicans understand the Old and New Testaments as containing all things necessary for salvation and as being the rule and ultimate standard of faith. Reason and tradition are seen as valuable means to interpret Scripture, a position first formulated in detail by Richard Hooker, but there is no full mutual agreement among Anglicans exactly how Scripture, reason and tradition interact or ought to interact with each other. Anglicans understand the Apostles' Creed as the baptismal symbol and the Nicene Creed as the sufficient statement of the Christian faith. Anglicans believe the Catholic and Apostolic faith is revealed in Holy Scripture and the Catholic creeds and interpret these in light of the Christian tradition of the historic Church, scholarship, reason and experience. Anglicans celebrate the traditional sacraments, with special emphasis being given to the Eucharist, also called Holy Communion, the Lord's Supper or the Mass. The Eucharist is central to worship for most Anglicans as a communal offering of prayer and praise in which the life, death and resurrection of Jesus Christ are proclaimed through prayer, reading of the Bible, singing, giving God thanks over the bread and wine for the innumerable benefits obtained through the Passion of Christ, the breaking of the bread, and reception of the bread and wine as representing the body and blood of Christ as in instituted at the Last Supper, while many Anglicans celebrate the Eucharist in similar ways to the predominant Western Catholic tradition, a considerable degree of liturgical freedom is permitted, and worship styles range from the simple to elaborate. Unique to Anglicanism is the Book of Common Prayer BCP, the collection of services that worshippers in most Anglican churches used for centuries. It was called Common Prayer originally because it was intended for use in all Church of England churches which had previously followed differing local liturgies. The term was kept when the church became international because all Anglicans used to share in its use around the world in 1549. The first Book of Common Prayer was compiled by Thomas Cranmer, who was then Archbishop of Canterbury. While it has since undergone many revisions and Anglican churches in different countries have developed other service books, the prayer book is still acknowledged. As one of the ties that bind the Anglican Communion together, Anglican identity. See also, History of the Anglican Communion, Early History, Shrine of St. Alban at the Anglican Cathedral and Abbey, Church of St. Alban. The founding of Christianity in Britain is commonly attributed to Joseph of Arimathea, according to Anglican legend, and is commemorated in Glastonbury Abbey. Many of the early church fathers wrote of the presence of Christianity in Roman Britain, with Tertullian stating, "Those parts of Britain into which the Roman arms had never penetrated were become subject to Christ." St. Alban, who was executed in 209 AD, is the first Christian martyr in the British Isles. Historian Heinrich Zimmer writes that just as Britain was a part of the Roman Empire, so the British Church formed during the 4th century a branch of the Catholic Church of the West, and during the whole of that century, from the Council of Arles 316 onward, took part in all proceedings concerning the Church after Roman troops withdrew from Britain. However, the absence of Roman military and governmental influence and overall decline of Roman imperial political power enabled Britain and the surrounding isles to develop distinctively from the rest of the West. A new culture emerged around the Irish Sea among the Celtic peoples, with Celtic Christianity at its core. What resulted was a form of Christianity distinct from Rome in many traditions and practices. Note 1. Historian Charles Thomas, in addition to Celticist Heinrich Zimmer, writes that the distinction between sub-Roman and post-Roman insular Christianity, also known as Celtic Christianity, began to become apparent around 475 AD, with the Celtic churches allowing married clergy, observing Lent. Of assuming Roman usages, the Celtic Church surrendered its independence, and from this point on, the Church in England was no longer purely Celtic, but became Anglo-Roman Celtic. Theologian Christopher L. Weber writes that although the Roman form of Christianity became the dominant influence in Britain as in all of Western Europe, Anglican Christianity has continued to have a distinctive quality because of its Celtic heritage. The Church in England remained united with Rome until the English Parliament, through the Act of Supremacy 1534, declared King Henry VIII to be the supreme head of the Church of England in order to fulfill the English desire to be independent from continental Europe religiously and politically. Although now separate from Rome, the English Church, at this point in history, continued to maintain the Roman Catholic theology on many things, such as the sacraments under King Edward VI. However, the Church in England underwent what is known as the English Reformation, in the course of which it acquired a number of characteristics that would subsequently become recognized as constituting a distinct, Anglican, identity. Development. See also, History of the Anglican Communion by the Elizabethan Settlement. The Protestant identity of the English and Irish churches was affirmed through parliamentary legislation which assumed allegiance and loyalty to the British Crown in all their members. However, from the first, the Elizabethan Church began to develop distinct religious traditions, assimilating some of the theology of Reformed churches with the services in the Book of Common Prayer, which drew extensively on the Sarum Rite native to England, under the leadership and organization of a continuing episcopate, and over the years these traditions themselves came to command adherence and loyalty. The Elizabethan settlement stopped the radical Protestant tendencies under Edward VI by combining the more radical elements of the Second Prayer Book of 1552 with the conservative Catholic First Prayer Book of 1549. From then on, Protestantism was in a state of arrested development, regardless of the attempts to detach the Church of England from its idiosyncratic anchorage in the medieval past by various groups which tried to push it towards a more reformed theology and governance in the years 1560-1660. Dermot McCullough, The Later Reformation in England, 1547-1603 pp. situation 100 years before, and there was also a tendency to take polemically binary partitions of reality claimed by contestants studied such as the dichotomies Protestant Popish or Laudian Puritan at face value. Since the late 1960s, these fallacies have been criticized. Studies on the subject written during the last 45 years have, however, not reached any consensus on how to interpret this period in English church history. The extent to which one or several positions concerning doctrine and spirituality existed alongside the more well-known and articulate Puritan movement and the Durham House Party, and the exact extent of continental Calvinism among the English elite and among the ordinary churchgoers from the 1560s to the 1620s are subjects of current and ongoing debate. In 1662, under King Charles II, a revised Book of Common Prayer was produced, which was acceptable to high churchmen as well as some Puritans, and is still considered authoritative to this day insofar as Anglicans derived their identity from both parliamentary legislation and ecclesiastical tradition. A crisis of identity could result wherever secular and religious loyalties came into conflict, and such a crisis indeed occurred in 1776 with the American Declaration of Independence, most of whose signatories were, at least nominally, Anglican. For these American patriots, even the forms of Anglican services were in doubt, since the prayer book rites of Matins, Evensong and Holy Communion, all included specific prayers for the British royal family. Consequently, the conclusion of the War of Independence eventually resulted in the creation of two new Anglican churches, the Episcopal Church in the United States in those states that had achieved independence, and in the 1830s the Church of England in Canada became independent from the Church of England in those North American colonies which had remained under British control and to which many loyalist churchmen had migrated reluctantly. Legislation was passed in the British Parliament, the Consecration of Bishops Abroad Act 1786, to allow bishops to be consecrated for an American church outside of allegiance to the British Crown, whereas no bishoprics had ever been established in the former American colonies, both in the United States and in Canada. The new Anglican churches developed novel models of self-government, collective decision-making, and self-supported financing that would be consistent with separation of religious and secular identities in the following century. Two further factors acted to accelerate the development of a distinct Anglican identity from 1828 and 1829, dissenters and Catholics could be elected to the House of Commons, which consequently ceased to be a body drawn purely from the established churches of Scotland, England and Ireland, but which nevertheless, over the following 10 years, engaged in extensive reforming legislation affecting the interests of the English and Irish churches, which by the Acts of Union of 1800, had been reconstituted as the United Church of England and Ireland. The propriety of this legislation was bitterly contested by the Oxford Movement Tractarians, who in response developed a vision of Anglicanism as religious tradition deriving ultimately from the ecumenical councils of the patristic church. Those within the Church of England opposed to the Tractarians, and to their revived ritual practices, introduced a stream of parliamentary bills aimed to control innovations in worship. This only made the dilemma more acute, with consequent continual litigation in the secular and ecclesiastical courts over the same period. Anglican churches engaged vigorously in Christian missions, resulting in the creation, by the end of the century, of over 90 colonial bishoprics, which gradually coalesced into new self-governing churches on the Canadian and American models. However, the case of John William Colenso, Bishop of Natal, reinstated in 1865 by the English Judicial Committee of the Privy Council over the heads of the church in South Africa, demonstrated acutely that the extension of episcopacy had to be accompanied by a recognized Anglican ecclesiology of ecclesiastical authority, distinct from secular power. Consequently, at the instigation of the bishops of Canada and South Africa, the first Lambeth Conference was called in 1867, to be followed by further conferences in 1878 and 1888, and thereafter at 10-year intervals. The various papers and declarations of successive Lambeth Conferences have served to frame the continued Anglican debate on identity, especially as relating to the possibility of ecumenical discussion with other churches. This ecumenical aspiration became much more of a possibility, as other denominational groups rapidly followed the example of the Anglican Communion in founding their own transnational alliances: the Alliance of Reformed Churches, the Ecumenical Methodist Council, the International Congregational Council, and the Baptist World Alliance. Theories in their rejection of absolute parliamentary authority, the Tractarians, and in particular John Henry Newman, looked back to the writings of 17th-century Anglican divines, finding in these texts the idea of the English Church as a via media between the Protestant and Catholic traditions. This view was associated, especially in the writings of Edward Bouverie Pusey, with the theory of Anglicanism as one of three branches alongside the Catholic Church and the Orthodox Church, historically arising out of the common tradition of the earliest ecumenical councils. Newman himself subsequently rejected the theory of the via media, as essentially historicist and static, and hence unable to accommodate any dynamic development within the Church. Nevertheless, the aspiration to ground Anglican identity in the writings of the 17th-century divines, and in faithfulness to the traditions of the Church Fathers, reflects a continuing theme of Anglican ecclesiology, most recently in the writings of Henry Robert McAdoo. The Tractarian formulation of the theory of the via media was essentially a party platform, and not acceptable to Anglicans outside the confines of the Oxford movement. However, the theory of the via media was reworked in the ecclesiological writings of Frederick Denison Maurice, in a more dynamic form that became widely influential. Both Maurice and Newman saw the Church of England of their day as sorely deficient in faith, but whereas Newman had looked back to a distant past when the light of faith might have appeared to burn brighter, Maurice looked forward to the possibility of a brighter revelation of faith in the future. Maurice saw the Protestant and Catholic strands within the Church of England as contrary but complementary, both maintaining elements of the true Church, but incomplete without the other, such that a true Catholic and evangelical Church might come into being by a union of opposites. Central to Maurice's perspective was his belief that the collective elements of family, nation and Church represented a divine order of structures through which God unfolds his continuing work of creation. Hence, for Maurice, the Protestant tradition had maintained the elements of national distinction which were amongst the marks of the true universal Church, but which had been lost within contemporary Roman Catholicism in the internationalism of centralized papal authority within the coming universal Church that Maurice foresaw. National churches would each maintain the six signs of Catholicity: baptism, Eucharist, the creeds, scripture, an episcopal ministry, and a fixed liturgy which could take a variety of forms in accordance with divinely ordained distinctions in national characteristics. Not surprisingly, this vision of a becoming universal Church as a congregation of autonomous national churches proved highly congenial in Anglican circles, and Maurice's six signs were adapted to form the Chicago Lambeth Quadrilateral of 1888. In the latter decades of the 20th century, Maurice's theory, and the various strands of Anglican thought that derived from it, have been criticized by Stephen Sykes, who argues that the terms Protestant and Catholic as used in these approaches are synthetic constructs denoting ecclesiastic identities unacceptable to those to whom the labels are applied. Hence, the Catholic Church does not regard itself as a party or strand within the universal Church, but rather identifies itself as the universal Church. Moreover, Sykes criticizes the proposition, implicit in theories of via media, that there is no distinctive body of Anglican doctrines, other than those of the universal Church, accusing this of being an excuse not to undertake systematic doctrine at all. Contrarywise, Sykes notes a high degree of commonality in Anglican liturgical forms, and in the doctrinal understandings expressed within those liturgies. He proposes that Anglican identity might rather be found within a shared consistent pattern of prescriptive liturgies, established and maintained through canon law, and embodying both a historic deposit of formal statements of doctrine, and also framing the regular reading and proclamation of Scripture. Sykes nevertheless agrees with those heirs of Maurice who emphasize the incompleteness of Anglicanism as a positive feature, and quotes with qualified approval the words of Michael Ramsay, "For while the Anglican Church is vindicated by its place in history, with a strikingly balanced witness to gospel and church and sound learning, its greater vindication lies in its pointing through its own history to something of which it is a fragment. Its credentials are its incompleteness, with the tension and the travail of its soul it is clumsy and untidy, it baffles neatness and logic, for it is not sent to commend itself as the best type of Christianity, but by its very brokenness to point to the universal Church wherein all have died. Doctrine main article, Anglican doctrine, Catholic and Reformed." In the time of Henry VIII, the nature of Anglicanism was based on questions of jurisdiction, specifically, the belief of the Crown that national churches should be autonomous, rather than theological disagreement. The effort was to create a national church in legal continuity with its traditions, but inclusive of certain doctrinal and liturgical beliefs of the Reformers. The result has been a movement with a distinctive self-image among Christian movements. The question often arises as to whether the Anglican Communion should be identified As a Protestant or Catholic Church, or perhaps as a distinct branch of Christianity altogether, the distinction between Reformed and Catholic, and the coherence of the two, is routinely a matter of debate both within specific Anglican churches and throughout the Anglican Communion by members themselves. Since the Oxford movement of the mid-19th century, many churches of the Communion have revived and extended liturgical and pastoral practices similar to Roman Catholicism. This extends beyond the ceremony of high church services to even more theological significant territory, such as sacramental theology. See Anglican sacraments. While Anglo-Catholic practices, particularly liturgical ones, have resurfaced and become more common within the tradition over the last century, there remain many places where practices and beliefs remain on the more Reformed or Evangelical side. See Sydney Anglicanism Guiding Principles. Richard Hooker 1554-1600, one of the most influential figures in shaping Anglican theology and self-identity for High Church Anglicans, doctrine is neither established by a magisterium, nor derived from the theology of an eponymous founder such as Calvinism, nor summed up in a confession of faith beyond the ecumenical creeds such as the Lutheran Book of Concord. For them, the earliest Anglican theological documents are its prayer books, which they see as the products of profound theological reflection, compromise and synthesis. They emphasize the Book of Common Prayer as a key expression of Anglican doctrine. The principle of looking to the prayer books as a guide to the parameters of belief and practice is called by the Latin name lex orandi, lex credendi. The law of prayer is the law of belief. Within the prayer books are the fundamentals of Anglican doctrine, the Apostles and Nicene Creeds, the Athanasian Creed now rarely used, the Scriptures via the lectionary, the sacraments, daily prayer, the Catechism and Apostolic Succession in the context of the historic threefold ministry for some low church and evangelical Anglicans. The 16th century Reformed 39 Articles form the basis of doctrine distinctives of Anglican belief. The 39 Articles played a significant role in Anglican doctrine and practice following the passing of the 1604 canons. All Anglican clergy had to formally subscribe to the Articles. Today, however, the Articles are no longer binding, but are seen as a historical document which has played a significant role in the shaping of Anglican identity. The degree to which each of the Articles has remained influential varies on the doctrine of justification. For example, there is a wide range of beliefs within the Anglican Communion, with some Anglo-Catholics arguing for a faith with good works and the sacraments at the same time. However, some evangelical Anglicans ascribe to the Reformed emphasis on sola fide, faith alone, in their doctrine of justification. See Sydney Anglicanism. Still other Anglicans adopt a nuanced view of justification, taking elements from the early church fathers, Catholicism, Protestantism, liberal theology and latitudinarian thought. Arguably, the most influential of the original Articles has been Article 6 on the sufficiency of Scripture, which says that Scripture containeth all things necessary to salvation, so that whatsoever is not read therein, nor may be proved thereby, is not to be required of any man, that it should be believed as an article of the faith, or be thought requisite or necessary to salvation. This article has informed Anglican biblical exegesis and hermeneutics since earliest times. Anglicans look for authority in their standard divines. See below. Historically, the most influential of these, apart from Cranmer, has been the 16th century cleric and theologian Richard Hooker, who after 1660 was increasingly portrayed as the founding father of Anglicanism. Hooker's description of Anglican authority as being derived primarily from Scripture, informed by reason, the intellect and the experience of God and tradition, the practices and beliefs of the historical church, has influenced Anglican self-identity and doctrinal reflection perhaps more powerfully than any other formula. The analogy of the three-legged stool of Scripture, reason, and tradition is often incorrectly attributed to Hooker. Rather, Hooker's description is a hierarchy of authority, with Scripture as foundational and reason and tradition as vitally important, but secondary, authorities. Finally, the extension of Anglicanism into non-English cultures, the growing diversity of prayer books and the increasing interest in ecumenical dialogue, has led to further reflection on the parameters of Anglican identity. Many Anglicans look to the Chicago Lambeth Quadrilateral of 1888 as the sine qua non of communal identity. In brief, the Quadrilateral's 4 points are the Scriptures, as containing all things necessary to salvation, the Creeds specifically, the Apostles and Nicene Creeds as the sufficient statement of Christian faith, the dominical sacraments of baptism and Holy Communion, and the historic Episcopate Anglican Divines redirects here for the 2016 film, see Divines film. See also, John Donne, George Herbert, and William Laud. William Laud within the Anglican tradition, Divines are clergy of the Church of England whose theological writings have been considered standards for faith, doctrine, worship and spirituality and whose influence has permeated the Anglican Communion in varying degrees through the years. While there is no authoritative list of these Anglican divines, there are some whose names would likely be found on most lists, those who are commemorated in lesser feasts of the Anglican churches and those whose works are frequently anthologized. The corpus produced by Anglican divines is diverse. What they have in common is a commitment to the faith as conveyed by Scripture and the Book of Common Prayer, thus regarding prayer and theology in a manner akin to that of the Apostolic Fathers. On the whole, Anglican divines view the via media of Anglicanism not as a compromise, but as a positive position, witnessing to the universality of God and God's kingdom working through the fallible, earthly Ecclesia Anglicana. These theologians regard Scripture as interpreted through tradition and reason as authoritative in matters concerning salvation. Reason and tradition, indeed, is extant in and presupposed by Scripture, thus implying cooperation between God and humanity, God and nature, and between the sacred and secular. Faith is thus regarded as incarnational and authority as dispersed among the early Anglican divines of the 16th and 17th centuries. The names of Thomas Cranmer, John Jewell, Matthew Parker, Richard Hooker, Lancelot Andrews and Jeremy Taylor predominate. The influential character of Hooker's Of the Laws of Ecclesiastical Polity cannot be overestimated. Published in 1593 and subsequently, Hooker's eight-volume work is primarily a treatise on church-state relations, but it deals comprehensively with issues of biblical interpretation, soteriology, ethics and sanctification. Throughout the work, Hooker makes clear that theology involves prayer and is concerned with ultimate issues, and that theology is relevant to the social mission of the Church. St. Mary's Church, Compton Dando, Somerset. The 18th century saw the rise of two important movements in Anglicanism: Cambridge Platonism, with its mystical understanding of reason as the candle of the Lord, and the Evangelical Revival, with its emphasis on the personal experience of the Holy Spirit. The Cambridge Platonist movement evolved into a school called Latitudinarianism, which emphasized reason as the barometer of discernment and took a stance of indifference towards doctrinal and ecclesiological differences. The Evangelical Revival, influenced by such figures as John Wesley and Charles Simeon, re-emphasized the importance of justification through faith and the consequent importance of personal conversion. Some in this movement, such as Wesley and George Whitefield, took the message to the United States, influencing the First Great Awakening and creating an Anglo-American movement called Methodism that would eventually break away, structurally, from the Anglican churches. After the American Revolution, by the 19th century, there was a renewed interest in pre-Reformation English religious thought and practice. Theologians such as John Keble, Edward Bouverie Pusey and John Henry Newman had widespread influence in the realm of polemics, homiletics and theological and devotional works, not least because they largely repudiated the old high church tradition and replaced it with a dynamic appeal to antiquity which looked beyond the Reformers and Anglican formularies. Their work is largely credited with the development of the Oxford movement, which sought to reassert Catholic identity and practice in Anglicanism. In contrast to this movement, clergy such as the Bishop of Liverpool, John Charles Ryle, sought to uphold the distinctly Reformed identity of the Church of England. He was not a servant of the status quo, but argued for a lively religion which emphasized grace, holy and charitable living, and the plain use of the 1662 Book of Common Prayer interpreted in a partisan evangelical way without additional rituals. Frederick Denison Maurice, through such works as The Kingdom of Christ, played a pivotal role in inaugurating another movement, Christian Socialism. In this, Maurice transformed Hooker's emphasis on the incarnational nature of Anglican spirituality to an imperative for social justice. In the 19th century, Anglican biblical scholarship began to assume a distinct character, represented by the so-called Cambridge Triumvirate of Joseph Lightfoot, F.J.A. Hort and Brooke Foss Westcott. Their orientation is best summed up by Lightfoot's observation that life which Christ is and which Christ communicates, the life which fills our whole beings as we realize its capacities, is active fellowship with God. The earlier part of the 20th century is marked by Charles Gore, with his emphasis on natural revelation, and William Temple's focus on Christianity and society, while from outside England, Robert Layton, Archbishop of Glasgow, and several clergy from the United States have been suggested, such as William Porcher Dubose, John Henry Hobart 1775-1830, Bishop of New York 1816-30, William Meade, Phillips Brooks and Charles Henry Brent Churchmanship. See also, Churchmanship and Eastward-Facing Solemn High Mass, a Catholic liturgical phenomenon which re-emerged in Anglicanism following the Catholic revival of the 19th century. Churchmanship can be defined as the manifestation of theology in the realms of liturgy, piety and, to some extent, spirituality. Anglican diversity in this respect has tended to reflect the diversity in the traditions Reformed and Catholic identity. Different individuals, groups, parishes, dioceses and provinces may identify more closely with one or the other, or some mixture of the two. The range of Anglican belief and practice became particularly divisive during the 19th century when some clergy were disciplined and even imprisoned on charges of ritual heresy while, at the same time, others were criticized for engaging in public worship services with ministers of Reformed churches. Resistance to the growing acceptance and restoration of traditional Catholic ceremonial by the mainstream of Anglicanism ultimately led to the formation of small breakaway churches such as the Free Church of England in England 1844 and the Reformed Episcopal Church in North America 1873. Anglo-Catholic and some broad church Anglicans celebrate public liturgy in ways that understand worship to be something very special and of utmost importance. Vestments are worn by the clergy, sung settings are often used, and incense may be used nowadays. In most Anglican churches, the Eucharist is celebrated in a manner similar to the usage of Catholics and some Lutherans, though, in many churches, more traditional, pre-Vatican II, models of worship are common, e.g., in Eastern Eastward orientation at the altar, whilst many Anglo-Catholics derive much of their liturgical practice from that of the pre-Reformation English Church, others more closely follow traditional Roman Catholic practices. The Eucharist may sometimes be celebrated in the form known as High Mass, with a priest, deacon and subdeacon dressed in traditional vestments, with incense and Sanctus bells and with prayers adapted from the Roman Missal or other sources by the celebrant. Such churches may also have forms of Eucharistic adoration such as benediction of the Blessed Sacrament. In terms of personal piety, some Anglicans may recite the Rosary and Angelus, be involved in a devotional society dedicated to Our Lady, the Blessed Virgin Mary, and seek the intercession of the saints. In recent years, the prayer books of several provinces have, out of deference to a greater agreement with Eastern conciliarism and a perceived greater respect accorded Anglicanism by Eastern Orthodoxy than by Roman Catholicism, instituted a number of historically Eastern and Oriental Orthodox elements in their liturgies, including introduction of the Trisagion and deletion of the Filioque clause from the Nicene Creed. For their part, those evangelical and some broad church Anglicans who emphasize the more Protestant aspects of the church stress the Reformation theme of salvation by grace through faith. They emphasize the two dominical sacraments of baptism and Eucharist, viewing the other five as lesser rites. Some evangelical Anglicans may even tend to take the inerrancy of Scripture literally, adopting the view of Article 6 that it contains all things necessary to salvation in an explicit sense. Worship in churches influenced by these principles tends to be significantly less elaborate, with greater emphasis on the liturgy of the Word, the reading of the Scriptures, the sermon and the intercessory prayers. The order for Holy Communion may be celebrated bi-weekly or monthly in preference to the daily offices, by priests attired in choir habit, or more regular clothes, rather than Eucharistic vestments. Ceremony may be in keeping with their view of the provisions of the 17th-century Puritans, being a Reformed interpretation of the ornaments rubric: no candles, no incense, no bells, and a minimum of manual actions by the presiding celebrant, such as touching the elements at the words of institution. In recent decades, there has been a growth of charismatic worship among Anglicans. Both Anglo-Catholics and evangelicals have been affected by this movement, such that it is not uncommon to find typically charismatic postures, music, and other themes evident during the services of otherwise Anglo-Catholic or evangelical parishes. The spectrum of Anglican beliefs and practice is too large to be fit into these labels. Many Anglicans locate themselves somewhere in the spectrum of the broad church tradition and consider themselves an amalgam of evangelical and Catholic. Such Anglicans stress that Anglicanism is the via media middle way between the two major strains of Western Christianity, and that Anglicanism is like a bridge between the two strains, sacramental doctrine and practice. Main article: Anglican sacraments in accord with its prevailing self-identity as a via media or middle path of Western Christianity. Anglican sacramental theology expresses elements in keeping with its status as being both a church in the Catholic tradition as well as a Reformed church. With respect to sacramental theology, the Catholic heritage is perhaps most strongly asserted in the importance Anglicanism places on the sacraments as a means of grace, sanctification and salvation as expressed in the Church's liturgy and doctrine of the seven sacraments. All Anglicans recognize baptism and the Eucharist as being directly instituted by Christ. The other five, confession and absolution, matrimony, confirmation. Holy orders also called ordination and anointing of the sick also called unction, are regarded variously as full sacraments by Anglo-Catholics, many High Church and some Broad Church Anglicans, but merely as sacramental rites by other Broad Church and Low Church Anglicans, especially evangelicals associated with Reform UK and the Diocese of Sydney. Eucharistic Theology Main Article, Anglican Eucharistic Theology. Anglican Eucharistic Theology is divergent in practice, reflecting the essential comprehensiveness of the tradition. Some Low Church Anglicans take a strictly memorialist Zwinglian view of the sacrament. In other words, they see Holy Communion as a memorial to Christ's suffering, and participation in the Eucharist as both a reenactment of the Last Supper and a foreshadowing of the heavenly banquet, the fulfillment of the Eucharistic promise. Other Low Church Anglicans believe in the real presence but deny that the presence of Christ is carnal or is necessarily localized in the bread and wine, despite explicit criticism in the 39 Articles. Many High Church or Anglo-Catholic Anglicans hold, more or less, the Catholic view of the real presence as expressed in the doctrine of transubstantiation, seeing the Eucharist as a liturgical representation of Christ's atoning sacrifice with the elements actually transformed into Christ's body and blood. The majority of Anglicans, however, have in common a belief in the real presence, defined in one way or another to that extent. They are in the company of the continental reformer Martin Luther rather than Ulrich Zwingli. A famous Anglican aphorism regarding Christ's presence in the sacrament is found in a poem by John Donne. He was the word that spake it, he took the bread and brake it, and what that word did make it, I do believe and take it. An Anglican position on the Eucharistic sacrifice, sacrifice of the Mass, was expressed in the response Sapius Officio of the Archbishop of Canterbury and York to Pope Leo XIII's a papal encyclical Apostolicae Curiae. Anglican and Catholic representatives declared that they had substantial agreement on the doctrine of the Eucharist in the Windsor Statement on Eucharistic Doctrine from the Anglican Roman Catholic International Consultation 1971 and the elucidation of the Archic Windsor Statement 1979. The final response 1991 to these documents by the Vatican made it plain that it did not consider the degree of agreement reached to be satisfactory practices. For more details on the daily Anglican morning office, see Morning Prayer Anglican. See also, Evening Prayer Anglican and Prayer of Humble Access. In Anglicanism there is a distinction between liturgy, which is the formal public and communal worship of the Church, and personal prayer and devotion, which may be public or private. Liturgy is regulated by the prayer books and consists of the Holy Eucharist, some call it Holy Communion or Mass, the other six sacraments, and the Divine Office or Liturgy of the Hours. Book of Common Prayer. The 1596 Book of Common Prayer. The Book of Common Prayer BCP is the foundational prayer book of Anglicanism. The original Book of 1549, revised 1552, was one of the instruments of the English Reformation, replacing the various uses or rites in Latin that had been used in different parts of the country with a single compact volume in the language of the people, so that now from henceforth all the realm shall have but one use. Suppressed under Queen Mary I, it was revised in 1559, and then again in 1662, after the restoration of Charles II. This version was made mandatory in England and Wales by the Act of Uniformity and was in standard use until the mid-20th century with British colonial expansion from the 17th century onwards. Anglican churches were planted around the globe. These churches at first used and then revised the Book of Common Prayer until they, like their parent church, produced prayer books which took into account the developments in liturgical study and practice in the 19th and 20th centuries, which come under the general heading of the liturgical movement worship. See also, Church of England Parish Church. Anglican worship services are open to all visitors. Anglican worship originates principally in the reforms of Thomas Cranmer, who aimed to create a set order of service like that of the pre-Reformation Church but less complex in its seasonal variety and set in English rather than Latin. This use of a set order of service is not unlike the Catholic tradition. Traditionally the pattern was that laid out in the Book of Common Prayer, although many Anglican churches now use a wide range of modern service books written in the local language. The structures of the Book of Common Prayer are largely retained. Churches which call themselves Anglican will have identified themselves so because they use some form or variant of the Book of Common Prayer in the shaping of their worship. Anglican worship, however, is as diverse as Anglican theology. A contemporary low church service may differ little from the worship of many mainstream non-Anglican Protestant churches. The service is constructed around a sermon focused on biblical exposition and opened with one or more Bible readings and closed by a series of prayers both set and extemporized and hymns or songs. A high church or Anglo-Catholic service, by contrast, is usually a more formal liturgy. Celebrated by clergy in distinctive vestments and may be almost indistinguishable from a Roman Catholic service, often resembling the pre-Vatican II Tridentine Rite. Between these extremes are a variety of styles of worship, often involving a robed choir and the use of the organ to accompany the singing and to provide music before and after the service. Anglican churches tend to have pews or chairs, and it is usual for the congregation to kneel for some prayers but to stand for hymns and other parts of the service, such as the Gloria, Collect, Gospel reading, Creed, and either the preface or all of the Eucharistic prayer. High Anglicans may genuflect or cross themselves in the same way as Roman Catholics. Other more traditional Anglicans tend to follow the 1662 Book of Common Prayer, and retain the use of the King James Bible. This is typical in many Anglican cathedrals and particularly in royal peculiars such as the Savoy Chapel and the Queen's Chapel. These services reflect the original Anglican doctrine and differ from the traditional Anglican communion in that they are in favor of women vicars and the ability of vicars to marry. These Anglican church services include classical music instead of songs, hymns from the New English Hymnal, usually excluding modern hymns such as Lord of the Dance, and are generally non-evangelical and formal in practice due to their association with royalty. These churches are generally host to staunch Anglicans who are strongly opposed to Catholicism. Until the mid-20th century, the main Sunday service was typically morning prayer, but the Eucharist has once again become the standard form of Sunday worship in many Anglican churches. This again is similar to Roman Catholic practice. Other common Sunday services include an early morning Eucharist without music, an abbreviated Eucharist following a service of morning prayer, and a service of evening prayer, sometimes in the form of sung evensong, usually celebrated between 3 and 6. Churches may use freely structured or experimental forms of worship, including patterns borrowed from ecumenical traditions such as those of Tyse Community or the Iona Community. Anglo-Catholic parishes might use the modern Roman Catholic liturgy of the Mass or more traditional forms, such as the Tridentine Mass, which is translated into English in the English Missal, the Anglican Missal, or, less commonly, the Sarum Rite. Catholic devotions such as the Rosary, Angelus, and Benediction of the Blessed Sacrament are also common among Anglo-Catholic Eucharistic discipline. Only baptized persons are eligible to receive communion, although in many churches communion is restricted to those who have not only been baptized but also confirmed in many Anglican provinces. However, all baptized Christians are now often invited to receive communion, and some dioceses have regularized a system for admitting baptized young people to communion before they are confirmed. The discipline of fasting before communion is practiced by some Anglicans. Most Anglican priests require the presence of at least one other person for the celebration of the Eucharist, referring back to Christ's statement in Matthew chapter 18 verse 20, "When two or more are gathered in my name, I will be in the midst of them." Though some Anglo-Catholic priests, like Roman Catholic priests, may say private masses as in the Roman Catholic Church, it is a canonical requirement to use fermented wine for communion. Unlike in Roman Catholicism, the consecrated bread and wine are always offered to the congregation at a Eucharistic service, communion in both kinds. This practice is becoming more frequent in the Roman Catholic Church as well, especially through the neocatechumenal way. In some churches, the sacrament is reserved in a tabernacle or ombre with a lighted candle or lamp nearby. In Anglican churches, only a priest or a bishop may be the celebrant at the Eucharist. Divine Office Evensong at York Minster. All Anglican prayer books contain offices for morning prayer, matins, and evening prayer. Evensong in the original Book of Common Prayer. These were derived from combinations of the ancient monastic offices of matins and lauds, and Vespers and Compline respectively. The prayer offices have an important place in Anglican history prior to the Catholic revival of the 19th century, which eventually restored the Holy Eucharist as the principal Sunday liturgy, and especially during the 18th century, a morning service combining matins, the litany, and anti-communion comprised the usual expression of common worship, while matins and evensong were sung daily in cathedrals and some collegiate chapels. This nurtured a tradition of distinctive Anglican chant applied to the canticles and